2018 is about to end, ladies and gentlemen. It's going to have a very wonderful ending, and I cannot wait for what's to come in 2019. But before we enter the uncharted realms that is 2019, and before I actually begin doing my final meme stream of the year, which is going to be very long and in epic proportions, I do want to talk about something that I've had in mind. I've talked about a lot of things in here, but the one industry that I'm paying attention to the most is none other than the gaming industry. And since we're ending this year, I think we should talk about the many notable events of the gaming industry in 2018 that I think a lot of game publishers and developers really need to take notes from. This is my list of pretty much quite a lot of the oopsie doopsies of the 2018 gaming, and let's hope that for the love of God, none of these corporations ever repeat the same mistakes again. Or do so, because that would make great YouTube content for pretty much everyone on this godforsaken website. Thankfully, my new patrons always gave me new hope for this world. Huge thanks to Funicon and A7, you guys are fantastic. At this point, I think you guys should know that Fallout 76 is a disappointing mess of a game who's based on an idea that wasn't even that good to begin with, a multiplayer-based FPS Fallout game that takes a lot of elements from survival games that uses the same game engine to the specifics of the building process. Considering how extremely buggy Bethesda games are on release, I predicted that Fallout 76 is gonna be an epic failure of massive proportions. It was that. But my god, the scale of the failure that was Fallout 76 was unprecedented. I have never seen a gaming company fail this bad on just one game in so many aspects in the past 10 years. Fallout 76 failed so badly in pretty much a lot of departments. It's not just the bugs and the shallow and empty nature of the game's world, it's also the many horrendous business practices outside of it. The Power Armor bag that came with the Power Armor edition of the game isn't the bag that people wanted, rewarding people with an insanely small and unworthy in-game money for the damages that it had done, an amount that is actually cheaper than the cost of the actual duffel bags in-game. And the most egregious for me at least was that time where Bethesda accidentally leaked a lot of personal information of the players. I could go on and on about the kinds of controversy that Fallout 76 has. I could even take up an entire video explaining and chronologically going through all the failures that Fallout 76 has, but the controversy that was this game is still going even to this day. The more and more we get through the day, the more and more this game screws up. The only question is how bad this game would screw up again. And honestly, I don't really know. It's Bethesda. Expect the absolute worst. Battlefield 5. What else do I have to say about Battlefield 5 that anyone hasn't said already? The game presents itself as an authentic World War II experience. The trailers showed that it isn't. People who demanded a more authentic World War II experience are pissed that they didn't get the game that they wanted. EA tells you that if you don't like the game, you don't have to buy it. And people took that advice and, well, not by the game. This is one of the many major factors that caused EA stocks to drop into oblivion, the lowest point that it's ever been for the past 2 years. Is there anything else that needed to be said about Battlefield 5? Oh yeah, what about that close launch event that promoted one really dumb hashtag, everyone's Battlefield, mocking people's criticisms along the lines of, feminists ruin everything, feminazis are trying to rewrite history. That's actually a hilarious statement, because considering the single player campaign that you're trying to do in that same game, you are trying to rewrite history. So what essentially happens here is you're mocking people's criticisms about the game, even though that criticism accurately describes what you're trying to do on that game. I mean, goddamn, I don't know what it takes to fail this bad, but Battlefield 5, you are just close second to Fallout 76 for being an absolute failure this year. The only successful thing that Battlefield 5 has ever done is exposing the false hype that was real-time ray tracing. This is a game that started off pretty well. When this game was announced, it was at a time where dark, gritty reboots are trending. I myself am quite excited with this game, but then again, I was 14. And when this game launched, a lot of people praised this game left and right for being an excellent reboot that tells a marvelous story of one of the gaming's most iconic female characters. I, for one, think that Tomb Raider 2013 was a game that failed on its origin story, providing a main character that is about as charismatic as a blank sheet of paper and a bland story that wouldn't even make pass straight to DVD. The gameplay is pretty good, admittedly, but considering that the story is one of the things that the game advertised the most, I feel nothing but disappointment. end. And that's exactly how I felt with the rest of the series. Nothing but disappointment. Except as the series goes on, my expectations are getting lesser and lesser, to the point where I won't even consider buying the next game. But well, it's a reboot Tomb Raider game and I am interested with the concept. I need to see if they can actually pull it off in a final game. They didn't. This game is about as every bit as underwhelming as the second game. It doesn't offer us anything new, the writing hasn't improved. I can even make the argument that Lara Croft is not a hero at all in this game and should be the villain of the story considering the amount of damage that she has done throughout the game. And despite all of the disappointments and rage that this game has given to me, the series ended in a really weak note. It's like the last puff of air that came out of a deflating balloon. It didn't end with a bang, it just comes and goes as if nothing ever happened. I'm glad that people recognize how this game is really not worth that $60 price. I bought this game on that price, and while I am satisfied with my purchase because I don't care about the value and I just want to get this game as quick as possible, there are those who complain about this game being on sale a month after release, probably because the game sold poorly. It's baffling that an iconic game like Tomb Raider would have sales this poor and gets discounted this soon after release. I think after how underwhelming the second game was, people started to realize that this game really isn't worth the asking price. And this was the story of Shadow of the Tomb Raider, a game that, in my opinion, failed so miserably this year simply for being so insignificant. This might not be much of a failure for you guys, but I have a hate relationship with this reboot series for such wasted potential. And this is my video, so the game will be in here. Which begs the question, why are the games that failed so much this year ended up being pretty good benchmarking utilities? 2018 is the year where mobile gaming has dominated the market for years now, but 2018 is where they decided to sneak in into the big players of the real gaming market and attempt to steal the hearts of the actual gaming crowd. One of the events that really grabbed the attention of a lot of the actual gamers is BlizzCon and the announcement for the game Diablo Immortal. I think the announcement for Diablo Immortal is one of the signs that the modern Western gaming industry has truly lost its touch with its audiences. Seriously, can you explain to me why would you announce a game that would definitely piss off your core gaming demographic? Why would you say to all the people in your audiences, hey, Diablo 4 is not really in the works, but we are working with a Chinese company making a game for mobile. I mean, you guys have phones, right? You guys can play these games on your phones, right? That, my friend, is one of the quotes that I think would haunt a lot of gaming enthusiasts in the upcoming years. Mobile gaming is becoming easier and more convenient as time went on. They're getting so easy and convenient, people won't even care how inconvenient the inputs are. As long as the normies can play PUBG Mobile on the smartphone with their friends, who cares about the inputs? It's a natural battle royale game that is free to play. The fact that this game is multiplayer also really helps the spread of the mobile gaming infection. My brother even takes it to the next level and just straight up emulate the Android on his laptop so that he can play PUBG Mobile with his friends who has phones instead of, you know, playing the actual PUBG on the PC. But at least PUBG Mobile is just a side project, a port of a game that already exists on a PC. What does Blizzard have to offer with Diablo? The existence of Diablo 4 is still a mystery to this day, and that's the news that people care about the most, instead of the lazy hack job mobile game, a game that the majority of your fans don't want in a platform that a majority of your fans don't play in. I know that some people like game journalists might say, hey, you don't have to get angry with the game, you don't have to be toxic on the internet, you can just ignore the game and not buy the game at all. Here's the thing, Resident Dissenter, we get angry so that you people can understand why we think that your current content is not worthy of purchase. We get angry so that you can understand why we won't spend our money on your product. We get angry so that you can understand our complaints. We are the ones who get to decide if your content is worthy of purchase, and you need us to purchase your content for you to survive. This is very simple economics. If you're gonna smear gamers as angry or entitled or uneducated, go right ahead. If you're gonna double down on your practices and ignore our concerns, go right ahead. But one thing I can say for sure is that none of you game companies will be getting the money for all of these games. It has been proven time and time again. Games that are worthy of purchase gets good sales. Games that are not should be very lucky for being used as benchmarking utilities. One of the most unfortunate video game failures this year was the closure of Telltale Games, a sudden and abrupt close that caused a lot of employees to get fired without being noticed. Unfortunately, Telltale Games have shown to us what would happen if you sold out your video game company so much to a lot of pop culture IPs that you couldn't even handle the amount of games being developed and published. And the game quality gets weaker and weaker and weaker every single time, with a couple of bumps here and there, but still couldn't reach the amount of perfection that was the first Walking Dead game. Ever since the closure of Telltale, a lot of discussions have centered around the game developer's workplace and how emotionally and physically taxing the work is. A lot of employees are undervalued, their opinions are not considered, they're not being given any sorts of break, and all of that with them getting paid less. But then again, that's one of the key consequences that you have to endure if you are getting into gaming development at all, especially big gaming companies. You have to endure the work ethic and the stress that these companies had to put you through. But still, none of this is okay, and there's not much that the consumers can do to fix that. Consumers are always going to be looking on the end result of a product, and they don't really care how much sweat, blood, relationships, or any kind of sacrifice they're wasted when these games are developed. I do want to sympathize with the game developers out there, but I, as a consumer, are only going to be looking at the end product. The only thing that we as consumers can do is to buy these games and talk about them. This is a topic that I think is worthy of a discussion in another video, but for now, I'll say this. Game development, especially with big companies, is something that you should really think carefully as long and hard as possible. Out of all the consoles, I think the PS4 is the one that gets all the glorious popularity and sales this year. I can't exactly blame them. The exclusives like God of War and Spider-Man are selling like hotcakes. The console exclusives like Red Dead Redemption 2 and, for a brief period, Monster Hunter World are also enjoying their places in the platform. Even Detroit Become Human is something that gets people talking. It's not a great game, and you might argue that it is pretty forgettable as far as Quantic Dream's game go, but it is a game that do left a significant impact to a lot of people this year, mostly for the Connor memes. Sony is incredibly lucky this year. If it weren't for God of War and Spider-Man being really solid exclusive this year, they wouldn't have a leg to stand on. To me, the PS4 has little to no reason existing. They do have exclusives that are pretty damn good, but most of the games released today are multi-platforms anyway, and I can play them just fine in my 1050 laptop at the same and sometimes even better performance than the consoles. But what if the PS4 doesn't have that much exclusives? What if they're running out of God of Wars or Spider-Man's or Bloodborne's to exploit people in buying a PS4? Are there any other games that the PS4 can stand on? Well, there are still Japanese games that are going to be exclusively released on the PS4, and some of them are going to be fan service oriented games. Oh, wait a second. No, you don't. All of these games are going to be censored left and right. Not only that these games got censored, but a lot of these games are multi-platform anyway, and the version on the other platform didn't have the game censored. Seriously, is there any reason for anyone to own a PS4 in current year, especially when Sony themselves stated that the console is at its age and they're gonna consider announcing the PS5 and releasing it in about 2 or 3 years from now? Why don't you try building a gaming PC? That's where all the uncensored Japanese games are going to go right now. Not on Steam, obviously, but Steam isn't the only store out there. There are tons and tons of guides for you available on the internet on how to build your gaming PCs. And even if you don't have the components, you can at least still watch how people build them. The only reason to not know this knowledge at this point is because you're too lazy to do it. Ladies and gentlemen, you cannot be lazy with your gaming in current year, especially those who are fan of lewd games. They are coming to your lewd video games, and if nobody tells either Sony or Steam that this is unacceptable, they are not going to change. But maybe they don't want to change. Maybe they really don't want you on their platforms. In which case, the Nintendo Switch is shockingly the safest option to publish your lewd games. Considering that we get more tits on the Switch version, expect to see the console sales skyrocketing in the next year as if it hasn't been already. So I think those are all the biggest gaming oopsie doopsies that are worth talking about, or at least the ones that I can talk about in this time frame. I don't want to waste too much of your time. If there are more oopsie doopsies that I miss, you can post them in the comments down below. Don't forget that the final meme stream is coming at 29th of December, 6 p.m. EST. Happy New Year, everybody. I cannot wait for what 2019 has to offer.